news to get through, and actually happy news if you're a Man United supporter. United managed to win 4-1 against the odds against Newcastle the other day, and I'm happy, man. I'm over the moon, actually. Very, very much over the moon. I think prior to the match, a lot of United fans were very nervous about the game, understandably so, considering that we actually got pummeled, right, convincingly by Spurs 6-1 at home. And then we had the international break that essentially didn't give us a chance to kind of get back on a horse and basically, you know, go for it again. Those kind of international breaks after such a heavy loss can be a blessing and a curse. They can be a blessing because it allows people to go and clear their heads. And it could also be a curse because they don't give you an opportunity to just get back on it, right? And try and rewrite your wrongs. There's too much time elapses, and sometimes idle mind, you know, it can fester, negative thoughts, stories come out, players start talking on international break as Pogba did, and just kind of create some division. But somehow, I don't know what happened, but it might have reinvigorated us. And I think part of it might have to do with some of the rumours that came out about Bruno Fernandes having an argument during the Spurs game, so much so he had to get pulled off at halftime, him along with Matic. And then when he went on international break, supposedly he's not sold or convinced by Ole Gunnar Solskjaer's coaching techniques, blah de blah 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 blah. And I think these stories eventually ended up galvanizing the squad. I think Bruno Fernandes probably spoke in confidence with some friends about his doubts about Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. I'm sure that happened. He definitely spoke about Ole Gunnar Solskjaer's ability to manage United and obviously get us back to winning trophies. And like anybody else with eyes and ears, he's probably doubting whether or not Solskjaer has what it takes to get United back where we kind of, you know, rightfully should be. But I think, unfortunately, because he's not very familiar with the way rumours work and the way news sometimes leaks, he unfortunately ended up speaking out of turn or in confidence to somebody he shouldn't have spoken to, and that person ended up relaying it to all the usual heads. First of all, I think it kind of leaked to Duncan Castle and a few other people, and it got out. Now, don't be surprised going forward if you don't hear any more leaks from Bruno Fernandes' side. I think he's probably smart enough to identify who from his camp was probably likely to have leaked that or kind of passed the news on. So don't be surprised that's the last of the news. Somehow that kind of ended up galvanizing us. And then off the back of it, we also had the backstory of the Harry Maguire issue, playing terribly for England during the international break, getting sent off, and supposedly suffering from mental health issues. But regardless, from just a football fan point of view, because, you know, I don't know anything about the guy's personal life, he just hasn't been playing well, hasn't been playing like an £85 million centre back, and generally looks like somebody who has not necessarily acclimatized well to the bright lights of Old Trafford. And that's okay. I think because he's English, people are probably more adept to kind of give him the benefit of the doubt. I think if this was Paul Pogba, he would get written off a long time ago. But of course, I understand the climate. It is what it is. Support your player, but I would like United fans to probably be a little bit less fanatical about that sort of thing and kind of just back the club as opposed to individual players. All that kind of Martial, Pogba FC stuff is really odd. I've never really understood that kind of idea. I guess because we're so shit, the only good thing about our team is individuals, but I still think it's a bit bizarre. That aside, somehow Ole Gunnar Solskjaer decided not to drop Maguire, played him from the start, and it kind of paid dividends. It worked out pretty well, and he got a goal. Had a pretty decent performance, a blight for some misplaced passes, which I'll get onto later. But overall, solid performance, 4-1 away from home against a pretty decent Newcastle side prior to this match. I think this game, they actually showed where the actual levels are. But we started off pretty poorly, conceded an own goal in the first 2 minutes, which kind of set a bit of a precedent. You kind of felt, oh no, here we go again. Luke Shaw letting in a goal. Luke Shaw was obviously at fault for a couple of, or maybe more than a couple of goals against Tottenham. But if you look back at the game, because I rewatched it from the beginning to the end, I downloaded the match and kind of watched it without commentary just to kind of get an idea of the shape and what we were doing. I think we didn't do anything wrong in the first 5 to 10 minutes, to be honest. I think the goal came with just an unlucky circumstance. Shaw was trying to block the cross. Maybe he was a bit lazy in terms of how he swung his leg to it. It wasn't the purpose. He wasn't trying to push it out in a certain place. He was just trying to block it with his foot, and it ended up kind of looping over the gain into the goal. No problem. We reacted pretty well. We had control of the ball. I didn't necessarily feel that Newcastle had any sustained period of possession. All their good stuff was coming mostly through Saint-Maximin. Apart from that, I didn't really see them have any joy. Obviously, Shelby is always an issue when he gets on the ball. He's got great pass selection, great weight of pass, and just generally has good vision on him, so he's always dangerous. But he didn't have one of his better games, and he always normally turns up against United. He was pretty mediocre. So we were lucky in that respect, because Newcastle didn't actually pressure us or play with the low block to kind of nullify our attacks or press some of our players that have the special ability. So we were kind of allowed to kind of pop it around the place, and you know, as soon as that happened, players like Wan-Mata, players like Bruno Fernandes kind of came into there, and even Fred was playing really well, keeping the ball moving, you know, and rotating the ball in midfield. McTominay did a pretty good job, and from the first half an hour or so, we played pretty solidly, so much so Bruno Fernandes ended up scoring a pretty decent goal that was ruled offside, but that obviously showed that we were kind of gaining a footing on the game. Harry Maguire then steps up and scores a pretty decent header. And if I remember correctly, the actual header itself came off of the back of a pretty decent move on the left-hand side between Mata, James, and maybe Bruno Fernandes that then went out to Mata. He had a short contact for a corner and leads to a header from Maguire. Which another thing to say too about Daniel James, I thought Daniel James played pretty well, I'm gonna be honest. A lot of people have ragged on him, and I'm still not a believer. He's probably Man United quality, but I think in terms of some of our other players who have been, you know, some supporting members of the cast of our team, I look at some people like a Jason Park and all that. You know, maybe Daniel James isn't as good as Jason Park, but those kind of players who might not necessarily be an attractive option for other clubs, but they seem to do a job for Man United. I think Daniel James might be in that mold. I think if used well, if used with the right tactics, especially playing with against a team like Newcastle that dropped off, gave him loads of space. The amount of time Daniel James picked up the ball in a sort of number 10-ish position and just drove at defenders was extreme. He kept picking up the ball in that position, left hand side, and kind of having a drive. Now, of course, Daniel James probably needs to improve on his ability to beat a man, his dribbling ability to maybe drop a shoulder and destabilize a defender, pop on the other side and let off a shot or something. He needs to have some kind of go-to. At the moment, he kind of gets too close to the defender, then tries to jink to his right hand side to shoot, and by that time his feet are too close together and he just doesn't have an opportunity to open up his body. It'd be good if he had some sort of routine or something that he does. I'm again not too sure if there's something that he's trying to do, but just to add to his game, he's not going to turn into Leroy Sané overnight. That's not going to happen, but it would be good to see him kind of improve that. So I thought Daniel James played pretty well. Obviously, Mata was connecting really well on that side too. Luke Shaw had a really good first half. You know, look at the improvement in Luke Shaw. Once you have a bit of competition, sitting on the bench, Alex Telles, a Brazilian international, a proper Brazilian international, right? Somebody who was the captain for Porto, you know, numerous amounts of assists and goals. Obviously, most of them coming from the penalty spot, but a very competent left back. It's no surprise that first game back, Luke Shaw turns on and kind of performs the way that we'd expect him to perform now. I still think long term Luke Shaw isn't the answer. I think he's given enough opportunities to prove his worth at United and hasn't necessarily stepped up to the plate. I think we'll have to move on if we want to be a team challenging for trophies. You can't rely on Luke Shaw. He's too inconsistent. He's too injury prone. He's too inconsistent. Obviously, he doesn't take care of himself too much as well as he should do off the pitch as well. That's another marker of a player that probably is never going to reach the pinnacle of the game, but he played pretty well this game. I'm not gonna kind of take it away from him. And then we continued, of course, went into break half time, and then we came out in the second half all guns blazing, really. We kept the pressure on to Newcastle. Newcastle were pretty poor throughout, didn't really offer much, no service to Callum Wilson. Saint-Maximin was trying his best to basically beat six people in order to get the ball further up the pitch, but you know, we kept taking him out a few times, so much so I think he probably picked up an injury with the amount of fouls he was picking up inside the middle of the box. And McTominay did a pretty good job of screening the defender, so did Fred, who was probably unlucky to come off first. We made a couple of substitutions. Paul Pogba, Van de Beek came on, and the game, of course, changed. Quality on the pitch improved. Obviously, the presence of Paul Pogba just kind of drags a couple of defenders away, opened up the pitch even more. Wan-Mata was sublime throughout the entirety of the game, and Wan-Mata is another one where you just kind of feel to yourself, like, you know, again, he was unlucky because Mata's essentially played in Man United teams that have been below par, right? He's had to play with really, really crappy midfielders, right? He played alongside Mauro Fellaini for a long time. He played on the right hand side of a 4-4-2 midfield for a long time. He's really been given the short end of the stick, but I think the quality of Mata is still there, much like a Santi Cazorla. You play him in a team where essentially gives him license to do what he does best, drift in from the wings, ping balls across, play one touch football, have mobile players around him. He's going to be sublime. And Mata proved that. Really, really a majestic performance. I would easily give him man the match if it wasn't for maybe a couple of the other Sterling goals and stuff, but Mata was incredible. the Bruno Fernandes goal was definitely a good example of that. A great team move that basically starts, I guess, from the bottom of our half. You know, Van de Beek passing it, the ball into Pogba or somebody, I think, in the middle. It comes out again to the wing. Mata then pushes it back out. It comes out to Rashford. Rashford runs into the area and then makes a diagonal run. Bruno Fernandes are smart enough to make the opposite run and cuts it back. And Bruno Fernandes does like a Van Listeroy-esque finish, right, with that kind of angle that you shouldn't be shooting, that ends up having, you know, banging it in for top corner. Really, really great way for us to kind of take the lead. And off the back of that, somehow Aaron Wan-Bissaka manages to get himself on the score sheet too. His first goal playing for us, and it was a pretty decent goal too, on the overlap, a fullback kind of bombing forward on the overlap, banging a shot that went top corner. Was great to see, you know, but maybe his old winger potential or old winger abilities coming out there. And then Marcus Rashford kind of put the icing on the cake and finished the game 4-1. And Marcus Rashford too deserves a lot of credit. I'm obviously not sold on a guy playing up front as a centre forward. In the conventional sense, I don't think he can hold up the ball too well. He doesn't really make enough intelligent runs. But if Rashford is given the opportunity or the space as Newcastle gave him, because I don't know why everyone assumed Newcastle were just going to sit off deep, because we might not, as soon as you back off from us and you give us space, we have no answers. We can't really break a team down when we have a low, when we're confronted by a low block. But there was a lot of space in behind Newcastle. Rashford was tearing them apart, coming in from the wings. He stretched the defenders. He kept them occupied. If he's able to do that going forward, just as a makeshift striker, I think he's going to add another string to his bow. I still ultimately think his best position is coming off from the wings, especially from the left-hand side. Having the ability to shoot in either corner, of course. He might have to obviously develop his ability to play from the right too, because that might essentially be the way he ends up playing, especially with Cavani coming into the team. You'd imagine Martial will probably get favoured to play on his favoured left-hand side, and then Rashford to occupy the right. But he did play pretty well. He held up the line amazingly well, and essentially was rewarded with a pretty well decent, with a pretty well taken goal. Bruno Fernandes with a ball over the top pretty easily, aimed into space. Rashford runs into it, gets into the box, ends up sliding it underneath the keeper, who had a pretty decent game too, because he saved one of Bruno Fernandes' penalties and just generally was a bit of a beast in between the sticks. And you thought, oh no, we're gonna be one of those games in it where we face a kid that just, you know, is Mawon Nuya reincarnated for one game, but we successfully managed to kind of get the ball past him a few times. And again, man, happy with the win. I think it's a perfect way for us to look forward to the PSG game coming up. So that should be a bigger test, of course. I'm still believing that the next four games are definitely going to tell us a lot about the team, tell us a lot about whether or not Solskjaer will remain manager. I still think going forward, if we want to win trophies, if we want to get the best out of our players, and if we want to get the best out of this current regime, unfortunately, this regime where we're not necessarily going to get all the money in the world to spend on big players, if that's the case, we're going to need a manager who can get the best out of the players that he's got, who can coach them in the same way that, you know, you see Arteta coaching Arsenal, you see Klopp obviously bringing the best out of his players, Pep at Man City. We're just going to have one of those managers, because we don't have the infrastructure that would allow us to sign loads of players and get that right, because it's a little bit haphazard in that regard with our transfer policy. But that's a story for another day. Man United won 4-1 away from home at Newcastle, a much needed respite, much needed confidence boost for the team, and better for us too as supporters, in it. No one wanted to have another miserable week, not looking forward to watching Match of the Day, complaining on fan channels. Yeah, you know I mean, no one wanted that. Like, it was horrible after that 6-1. You know what I mean? It felt like everywhere I was turning, I was being reminded of just how crap we were. Now at least we have a little bit of a good feeling. Still, the problems are still there. No one's going to deny that, but at least we have something that we can hold on to going forward. Man United 4, Newcastle 1 away from home. This has been Stratford Red Devils Talk.